As you can probably imagine, I'm a bit of a Supreme Court nerd. And I couldn't wait for the audio of this case, Janus versus American Federation of State, County, and Municipal Employees Council 31, to come out. And that was supposed to be last week, but apparently they needed an extra week to finish typing out that title. Man, that case's name is so long, I'm surprised it didn't have a the second at the end. Especially because this case directly deals with a previous Supreme Court case, Abood versus Detroit Board of Education. Now, this case today deals with the question of whether it's a violation of your First Amendment rights to be forced to give a part of your wages to a union. This might sound like a relatively small issue, but it involves...
just a few things to put on the table. 23 states, the District of Columbia, Puerto Rico, all would have their statutes declared unconstitutional at once. Thousands of municipalities would have contracts invalidated. Those contracts probably cover millions, maybe up to over 10 million workers.
So this affects a lot of people. Let's get a little context. This conversation really starts with 1977's case, Abood versus Detroit Board of Education, which was less covered than Jennifer Lawrence in that controversial picture. Wow, none of the clothes, and she still looks like the second most comfortable one there, besides the guy in the far right who is clearly a plus one and only skimmed the dress code memo. Wait, so it's said that only women are the ones who are allowed to wear knee-high boots? I can thank my girlfriend for that last joke who watches E! Online while I write my jokes. So, what is this elusive Allude versus Detroit Board of Education case? Well, at the time, public school teachers in Detroit who weren't members of the teachers' union objected to being forced to pay union fees when they objected to the principles of collective bargaining and politics of the union they were being forced to support. And of course they did. I mean, they're public school teachers in Detroit. They're set for life. Now, this case went to the Supreme Court, and in a surprisingly unanimous decision, all of the justices sided with the unions. Although, objectors to the union membership or policy may have their dues not used for that ideological or political purpose, in a move that's about as effective as building the right half of a dam and then hoping for the best. Because, of course, using the pro-union funds for the controversial activities and then just use the rest for maintenance. The decision specifically said, the court apparently rules that public employees can be compelled by the state to pay full union dues to a union with which they disagree. Now, that apparently made sense in context that they were comparing it to private sector unions. It wasn't a dissenter passive-aggressively expressing his discontent while writing their decision. Apparently, this is a law now. So, it was found in 2014 that this activity is unconstitutional for the private sector, but now it's going up for debate in the public sector. So, let's see what happened.
We'll hear argument first this morning in case 16-1466, Janus versus the American Federation of State, County, and Municipal Employees.
At the heart of this case was an argument about the difference between compelled speech and restricted speech.
Well, the government's interest in restricting speech don't apply to compelling support for speech. In fact, oftentimes they cut the opposite way. So the government's interest in restricting speech, for example, in the Hatch Act, restricting political activities, wasn't preventing the politicalization of the workforce and preventing government employees from being organized into a political machine. Of course, those same interests don't justify forcing individuals to support the speech of an advocate.
But that's... so let's talk about the Hatch Act, because that was all over this debate. Fortunately for us, the Hatch Act has recently been in the news for an entirely different reason.
We start with that breaking news. Presidential Counselor Kellyanne Conway in violation of the Hatch Act.
Thank you, Trump administration, for making all sorts of obscure laws relevant and fun. So what did she do? Well, the Hatch Act forbids federal employees, exempting the president and vice president, from going on TV and advocating for certain candidates and policies. Basically, you can't go on Fox News and say,
and Doug Jones in Alabama, folks, don't be fooled. He'll be a vote against tax cuts. He's weak on crime, weak on borders. He's strong on raising your taxes. He's terrible for property owners.
So, and Doug Jones is a...
the argument here is that these chips away from free speech are designed to keep a non-politicized workspace, which is the opposite of what a union potentially does. This led to the idea that this is a compelled subsidy instead of direct compelled speech, though.
So long as you're not compelled or stopped from speaking when you disagree, we've said that's a compelled subsidy. And our members can come out any day they want and say they don't take the same position on a policy question as the Bar Association. Any union member is free to get up publicly in any setting he or she wants to say they don't agree with the position the union is taking, correct?
Correct.
Yes, you can speak out against something while you also give it money, kind of like buying the most recent Chris Brown album. It was further emphasized when someone pointed out that
the person who doesn't agree with the positions basically gets two cracks. One is to try to persuade the group that he's right, and if that doesn't fail, he still has his conscience and his speech to speak outside as a citizen to explain why that position is wrong.
Now, some people might be having trouble coming up with a situation where a worker would disagree with a union. It's a hard sell to stand up in a meeting and say, "Hey guys, why don't we try to not get better wages and benefits and instead just kind of ride it out? You know, see where things go." But there was a point when things seemed to get a little too personal for Justice Kennedy.
It can be a partner with us in the process of not only contract
negotiation. It can be a partner with you in advocating for a greater size workforce, against privatization, against merit promotion, against for teacher tenure, for higher wages, for massive government, for increasing bonded indebtedness, for increasing taxes. That's the interest the state has.
I'm sorry, but was his first knock on unions that they want to increase the workforce? Yeah, the rest of his points really do represent potential problems or political actions that are taken with the unions, though. Anyways, gee, I wonder which way he's voting on this one. So, nobody knows exactly how political unions are, but at one point it was asked,
I suppose that 80% of the fees of the union dues went to matters that were highly political in nature, and 20% to negotiations and grievances. Would that change your view?
I don't know that it would, Your Honor. The Abood case, the Keller case, Beck, Ellis, all of them.
Then it seems to me your argument doesn't have much weight.
If unions are 80% political, according to him, they would still necessitate taking funds from everyone they represent. Clearly Justice Kennedy thought he was on a roll, though, when he kept on going and asked,
if you do not prevail in this case, the unions will have less political influence, yes or no?
Yes, they will have less political influence.
But isn't that the end of this case?
He then gave himself a high five and rolled off the stage. The problem with this logic was that, mentioned earlier by the other side, is that a vast majority of what a union does is not supposed to be political. Just listen to this one moment in this case when Justice Sotomayor grills William Messenger like he's a kid who just broke a window.
Is it just the collective nature of the union? You're not suggesting that if an employee goes to the state and tries to negotiate his or her wages, that that's a First Amendment activity. We've said it's not, right?
Yes,
that employment-related issues are not entitled to First Amendment protection, correct?
Yes, Your Honor, generally speaking.
Generally speaking, the go-to yes response for people who want to leave a shred of doubt. You're about to meet its sister.
So, if an employee is disciplined by the state for some malfeasance, that's an employment-related issue not entitled to First Amendment protection?
Oftentimes.
Oftentimes.
Ooh, oftentimes? Well, we're getting closer to a yes, although it seems like Justice Sotomayor might be catching on.
If employees come to the state and want greater training, employment issue, correct?
Generally, yes.
So why does it transform into some entitlement to First Amendment protection merely because a collective body of employees are coming to the table at once?
The basic idea here is that pretty much everything a union does is not, legally speaking, a First Amendment issue, but rather an issue of compelling interest, a concept that we're going to touch on in a second. The big issue right now is, what is the difference between an individual going to his boss and demanding a raise, and all of the individuals going up to their bosses and demanding a raise simultaneously? And the response is scale.
As this court recognized in Harris, it's the scale. So here you have Ask Me bargaining over issues that affect hundreds of millions of dollars and affect thousands of employees across the board. The scale of that is what makes it a political...
Now this is interesting, because I expected to be talking about the case Harris versus Quinn as it relates to scale. But as I read the decision and the summaries, I could not find one mention of scale. In a desperate attempt, I even searched the documents for the word scale, and the closest thing to come up was Scalia. So maybe he tacked on that relevant case to try to give his point some credibility. That said, his point still stands, because in this case, a union would be negotiating for tens of millions of dollars of government money. And because we're talking about public employees, which could give this otherwise employment-related conversation a political edge? So now comes another question that comes up quite a few times.
Student activities fees, are they different, and if so, why? Another is a mandatory bar association payments.
Alright, so first, what is a student activity fee? Well, it's fees paid for by students who attend public universities, like tuition and dorm fees. So how is charging people fees for taking the bar exam or going to state schools, which is like a four-year bar exam, if you know what I mean, differences from mandating someone from paying a union fee? Well, it comes down to what the interest is. One would say,
the state bar associations are justified by the state's compelling government interest in regulating the practice of law before its courts. The student association fees are justified by the government's, or what a university's compelling interest in setting up a viewpoint-neutral forum for speech.
Which leaves the interest of a union undefined. That is, until someone pointed out that despite the fact that the government likes spending money like a multimillionaire's second wife, they still generally like there to be a point to it all.
The government purpose here is labor relations and labor peace. Why isn't that? You still haven't told me why that's not a compelling state interest.
Oh, all right. The compelling interest here is labor relations, which some people might find important, although some people prefer the drama of week-long teachers' strikes in West Virginia. When Solicitor General Francisco was brought in to speak, oh man, he sounds like the leader of a banana republic. Except, in this case, he doesn't like unions.
In terms of whether agency fees are necessary to further the compelling interest in having an exclusive bargaining representative on the other side of the table, I don't think there's really any basis for concluding that. For example, in the federal government, we don't have agency fees either in the government generally.
We also have more benefits that are given without unions.
Not in the Postal Service, Your Honor.
It's never a good sign when part of your defense is, you know, postal workers. That's the kind of labor relations we need more of. We could start a bring your rifle to work day. Oh man, that joke would have killed in the 90s. Anyways, General Francisco's anti-union arguments lay largely with the test called the Pickering test. This is perfect because it combines the scale argument and the censorship arguments we talked about at the top of this episode. So what is the Pickering test? This test was basically designed to establish what a public employee's freedom of speech is. You see, things can get a little muddled when you're a public employee, whether you're talking as a part of the government or as an individual. Take the Kellyanne Conway, for example. She got into trouble recently because she was speaking not as Kellyanne Conway, but as Counselor to the President Kellyanne Conway. For this test to protect you, you must be speaking as a private citizen about a matter of public concern, rather than speaking as an employee. So what does scale have to do with any of this? Well, the argument here is that when you have, rather than a private employee negotiating for higher wages, a group of organized employees arguing for higher wages, it suddenly transforms from an employment issue into an issue of public concern, where the employees, acting as official employees, are criticizing the system. Wow, this may make sense to some, but what an unnecessarily complicated way to express your hate for unions. Now, Before I end this episode, I do have to emphasize some slightly less legal and more moral points that were made.
Human nature and basic economics dictate that the free rider problem will become endemic, and not only that, but contagious. Because if I'm an employee and I stick with the union and others over time decide not to, my fees and my dues are going to go up and up and up, and the pressure on me to make the same choice will increase as well.
Apparently, people don't like spending money when they don't have to. And as people stop paying, fees get more expensive in a downward cycle that ends up disempowering unions. Another allegedly good reason for strong unions we hear is...
We have an interest, at the end of the day, in being able to work with a stable, responsible, independent counterparty that's well-resourced enough that it can be a partner with us.
Stability regarding labor relations is generally considered to be a good thing. Unless you're a fan of the Industrial Revolution, where workers had about as many rights as the boss's cat. That said, of course there's room for compromise, which will probably end up happening.
What Justice Scalia said was, it is fair to assign a fee for the services that the union by statute is required to provide.
Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello, YouTube. I hope you enjoyed that last video. For more episodes of Supreme Court Saturday, click here, and subscribe by clicking here. And if you enjoyed this episode, remember to like below.